Good evening. Mrs. Elizabeth, Peter Buckland, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Jag Humar, and I'm going to be your host this evening. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you all to this lecture. This is a way of our celebrating the legacy of John Ardalion. Nothing better than to invite a very distinguished engineer colleague to speak today. At this time, I'll invite Professor Paul Van Giel, our chair of the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering, to welcome you.
So good afternoon, everyone. It's my privilege and honor to, on behalf of the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering, to welcome you to our annual John Ardalion Lecture Series. We always look forward to an interesting talk on things related to structures and architecture and other areas that we deal with in our department. It's an often opportunity for us to reflect on the year that has gone by. It's always a busy year when we come around to March. Most of my colleagues are very tired at this point because there's only a couple of weeks left in the term and looking forward to the end of the term. But one of the things we're doing at Carleton is we're going through a renewal of our strategic integrated plan. And you're saying, well, what's that? Well, it's our strategic plan that the university is putting forward that looks forward as to what we want to do in the next 5 years. And they put together a committee, and that committee is going around talking to different units at the university and to faculty and staff and trying to get a feel for where the university sees itself. And they haven't reported back, but one of the things that they said in terms of talking to everybody, they discovered that there's so much exciting things that are going on at Carleton. And the other thing is that we don't advertise it. We don't tell people some of the exciting things that we're doing at Carleton. And I think the same thing applies to engineering, or even more so to engineering, and to our department. There's a lot of exciting things going on in the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering. When we start looking at our undergraduate class, the enrollments in civil engineering are very, very strong. The enrollments in environmental engineering are strong. We've started a new program in architectural conservation and sustainability, for which we have students now going into their third year next year. And that program is in high demand. At the graduate level, our students are excelling. You'll see later on in this evening's agenda, we're going to be presenting some awards, and the number of those awards grows each year. Some little things that appear, one of the things is we look at Ontario graduate scholarships. We're going through that process now, and it's changed somewhat, but in the past 3 or 4 years, we've always gotten 8 or 9 or 10 of these awards in our department. And now it's become internal here at Carleton. And so now I can compare our numbers to the rest of my departments, sister departments in the Faculty of Engineering and Design. And last year, for example, we had over 1/3 of the Ontario graduate scholarships that were awarded in engineering were in the Department of Civil and Environmental Engineering. So a reflection of some of the excellent students that we have at the graduate level as well. And then all of this only comes about when you've got a dedicated group of faculty members and staff that support the program, that encourage and engage our students and engage in research that gets recognition through refereed journal publications and those kinds of things. But sometimes we do have to call Carleton now and let them know about so-and-so being a guest lecturer at a conference or being awarded a special award, etc. So as a whole, the department is doing very, very well, and I'm very happy to be here every year to let you know how things are going in the department, and I look forward to the finish of this year and to the years that follow as we continue to build and strengthen our program. I would also like to extend a welcome to a few people. I will actually start by introducing our president, President Runte, who just snuck in. I would like to thank you for attending. I'd like to recognize Mrs. Ardalion and the Ardalion family for being here today, to Peter Buckland for accepting our offer to come and give this year's address. I'd also like to thank the committee that worked so hard in putting this together, Jag Humar, Halim Abdelhalim, Abbas Brema, Mario Santana, and Siv has done a tremendous amount of work. He wasn't originally assigned to the committee, but I think people recognized that he's a real resource, so he got pulled into the committee and has done a tremendous amount of work in the past few days in getting this event organized. I have to thank Kay at the back for all of her efforts in coordinating everything tonight. Chris, my departmental administrator, helps out, and also Pyle, our graduate administrator, helps out tremendously in putting together application packages for our students that apply for these awards that we're going to give out later tonight. But again, I'd like to extend a warm welcome to everyone on behalf of the department, and I hope you look forward to tonight's talk and talks in the future. And with that, I'll thank JAG for allowing me to welcome you and turn the floor back over to JAG. Thank you.
Thank you, Paul. This time, I'd like to say a few words of introduction to John at Jelly. And I've done this for the last 8 years, and it's always a pleasure to do it. I can find new things to say about him now, but because I have repeated all of these. But nevertheless, always a pleasure to talk of his accomplishments and his life. As I said earlier, this lecture series is our way of celebrating the legacy of Dr. John Edgelian. And I had the privilege of knowing him from 1975 until he passed away in 2004. So what I say is, of course, biased by my personal experience and my interaction with him. John was that person who combined the qualities of intellect, creativity, leadership, humility, compassion, and kindness. He touched the hearts of minds of many of those of us who knew him and were blessed in many ways. John was born of Armenian parents in Worcester, Massachusetts, and after serving in the U.S. Army, he enrolled at McGill University, where he earned a bachelor's degree in civil engineering in 1952. From McGill, he went on a scholarship to MIT, where he received an MSc in structural engineering in 1955. And soon afterwards, he returned to Canada to found a firm of Edgelian and Associates. And his firm quickly established a reputation in the city and outside. Over the years, it has provided structural consultancy for a large number of diverse structures, over 4,000, I'm told, some of which become recognized as outstanding examples of architectural and structural innovations. And his favorite ones were the Fathers of Confederation Building in Charlottetown, the National Arts Center here, the Aviation Museum of Ottawa, and the Sky Dome of Toronto, to name some of them. These slides you see are just a sample of some of the work that he had done, or his firm had done. And you also see him in another role as a university professor, being recognized here with an award. And four of us came at the same time to Carleton, myself, John Edgelian, Patrick Saladuri, and Juan Salinas. Patrick and Juan are not here today, but the other two of us are here in the picture as well as here in person. John joined the Department of Civil Engineering at Carleton in 1975, and he served as the chairman of the department from 1976 until 1982 when he took retirement and was appointed emeritus professor. During his tenure as chair, he established the department as a center of excellence in teaching and research in the field of engineering. And the department has ever since growing, as Paul just mentioned to you, and has made new strides. John was an exemplary teacher who inspired his students and instilled in them the values of his vision, exposing them to real-world problems. He encouraged teamwork that brought engineers and architects together. And in fact, he was that rare engineer who was admired and loved by the community of architects. And it's indeed a rare phenomenon. Many honors he received, John was proudest of his honorary membership in the Ontario Association of Architects. There was much to admire in John's personality, but what impressed me most were his human qualities, his humility, and his compassionate nature. John's company was perhaps only a medium-sized company with about 30 or 40 engineers, but the amount of work they did was phenomenal and a testament to the quality of his expertise and leadership. It was so surprising and so fine a gentleman that leadership came effortlessly to him. He always acknowledged the achievements of people working under him, and his kindness allowed him to carry people along. John was a AA personality, always on the move, but that never cost him anything in terms of wit, and his sense of humor, and particularly his self-deprecating humor, was always a source of joy and laughter. And he had a deep compassion that made him a wonderful person and a friend. And I repeat these stories every year, but they're never too old to repeat. They give you a sense of his sense of humor and his modesty. He was appointed emeritus professor at Carleton University, and he used to call himself unmeritorious professor. And then later on, he got an honorary doctorate from the Technical University of Nova Scotia, a doctorate of engineering honoris causa. And his favorite word was, I got a recognition as a doctorate without cause. Let me take a few moments to highlight what John's work has meant for Carleton. You've seen glimpses of his work throughout the country, in fact, outside. You don't see some here. But for Carleton, his firm has designed a majority of buildings on Carleton. You may not, however, know that his firm designed the Tory building, the first building to be built at the new campus. And then it went on to design the Loeb building, the Southam Hall, the library, the Peterson Hall, the Davidson Dunton Tower, the Robertson Hall, where you're seated, the Stacey building, the Minto Case building, and so on, and several residences. Carleton held a special place in John's heart, and he supported us in many ways. He set up an endowment fund that will in perpetuity recognize excellence in research and education by supporting outstanding graduate students. This John Edgelian Lecture has been established by the department to celebrate the standard of excellence exemplified by John. It is our way of celebrating the professional achievement of John, as well as his human qualities of honesty, integrity, humility, and compassion. It is our great privilege that to celebrate this occasion with us by presenting the 2013 lecturers, one of Canada's most distinguished engineers, Dr. Peter Buckland. It gives me great pleasure to invite my colleague, Professor Siva Sivathalan, to formally introduce our speaker and to request him to deliver the 2013 John Edgelian Lecture. Thank you.
Thank you, Jack. Good afternoon, Madam President, Mr. Chairman, and ladies and gentlemen. It's a pleasure to welcome all of you. It's a pleasure to welcome all of you to the 2013 John Edgelian Lecture and to introduce the speaker, Mr. Peter Buckland. Peter Buckland graduated from Cambridge in 1960 and spent the next 10 years or so working as a bridge engineer designing suspension bridges and cable stayed bridges in UK and in Canada. In 1970, he founded the first firm that he started, the Buckland and Associates, and 2 years later, the firm became Buckland and Taylor Limited, as it's well known today. Peter served as the president of the firm for about 30 years and is considered one of the key personalities who is responsible for the success of the firm and its reputation as a firm that leads in engineering excellence. Peter's firm specializes in different types of bridges, suspension, cable stayed, and others. And Buckland and Taylor's special expertise for the design and erection of cable stayed bridges is well recognized internationally with projects in United States, Europe, the Middle East, Asia, in addition to Canada. Buckland and Taylor Limited was involved in the work at Lionsgate Bridge since its inception, the firm's inception, that is, since 1972. And Peter was also the principal in charge of the work that was carried out in the 1990s to upgrade the bridge for seismic retrofit. And the work performed at Lionsgate during that time has included several world firsts and has won many awards, and has led to changes in the structure that has increased the capacity and the structural safety of the bridge. And personally, I witnessed all of this firsthand when I was in Vancouver at the time, trying to get across the first Narrows Bridge to get away from grad school. In 1987, Buckland and Taylor was responsible for the design of the Alex Fraser Bridge, which joins Richmond to New Westminster in BC. The 2.5 kilometer long bridge with about a 1500 feet midspan was the largest of its kind at the time, and it held on to that title for about another 20 years. The Alex Fraser Bridge introduced many features that have since become the standard in international practice in the construction of cable stayed bridges of that size. The firm also carried out independent design and consulting work at the Confederation Bridge on behalf of the Government of Canada. And then firm's expertise related to seismic evaluation led the firm to be appointed to the seismic retrofit of the Golden Gate Bridge in California, San Francisco, California. In addition, Peter has worked in well over 30 bridges in California at the time. Peter Buckland was a member of the ASCE Committee on Long-Span Steel Bridges, and his expertise on this front led to his appointment as the chair of the ASCE Committee on Loads and Forces on Bridges. His research into traffic loading was published in the 1980s, and he has served on committees writing the AASHTO Code on LRFD and the Canadian Highway Bridge Design Code. In addition to the various awards and recognition that Buckland and Taylor received under Peter's leadership, Peter's significant contributions to bridge engineering have been recognized from accolades from around the world. His contribution to the technical literature is very well recognized with various awards. Peter has been awarded the Gauske Gold Medal for the best technical paper and the Prattley Award for the best paper in bridge engineering from CSCE, both of them not once but twice. His international recognitions include the John Henry Garwood King Medal from the Institution of Civil Engineers, UK, for his paper on the reconstruction of the Lionsgate Bridge, and the Oscar Faber Award from the Institution of Structural Engineers in UK. The K.Y. Lowe Medal of the Engineering Institute of Canada, which recognizes a member who has made significant engineering contributions at the international level, was awarded to Peter in 2007. Peter Buckland was an elected fellow of the Canadian Society for Civil Engineering, of the Institution of Structural Engineers, UK, the Engineering Institute of Canada, and the Canadian Academy of Engineers. He was awarded an honorary doctorate in 1992 by the University of British Columbia in recognition of his contributions to bridge engineering. And Peter was appointed a member of the Order of Canada in 2008 for his contributions as a preeminent civil engineer, notably in the field of bridge design, construction, and rehabilitation. The Order of Canada obviously is Canada's highest honor for lifetime achievement. Tonight, we are fortunate to have Peter sharing with us some examples of interesting and original bridge engineering. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Peter Buckland, the 2013 John Abelian Lecturer.
Right, okay, well, this is a bit of a hard act to follow. First of all, I didn't know John Abelian personally, but my partner, Peter Taylor, did know him well and speaks very highly of him, so that much I know. And I certainly trust Peter's judgment. I was told that the talk to do with the Abelian lecture should relate to professional practice, research, and education. Okay, so starting with education, this is me standing up here talking to you. And there'll be an exam at the end, which Professor Humar will adjudicate. The professional practice has been fantastic, and you'll see as I go through this just what a wonderful career one can have, and this is just a tiny part. I started out full of enthusiasm to tell you about all many, many things that I've had experience with, and in the end, reduced it to two and a bit, one of which is the Lionsgate Bridge that has been mentioned, and I have talked about this before, so if you've seen it before, forgive me, but it's still pretty interesting, at least to me. The research bit, that's why I used the Lionsgate, really, because I think of all the projects I've done, a lot of them have involved research in one form or another, but that particular bridge sort of had more. So that way we can get to our three requirements. So without more ado, we'll carry on. But I'm not going to start with Lionsgate. I'm going to start with a very small bridge, but spectacular, over a canyon in sort of the middle of British Columbia, i.e. not really near anywhere. And that's a one-lane bridge. And although it's very small, it serves a very huge area, sparsely populated, but it's a vital link. And there were problems. So the first thing was that the deck, the roadway bit that the trucks actually travel on, vehicles, which is a grating deck, I'll show you a picture of that in just a sec, needed to be replaced for a bunch of reasons, partly because it was wearing out, but more particularly because it was causing structural problems on the bridge itself. So there's a view of the bridge. You can see it's very narrow. You can see the truck is very large. And we want to replace the deck. Now, how are we going to do it? Well, of course, you have to close the bridge to traffic when it's a one-lane bridge. Pick a piece of panel out with a crane, put it on a truck, take it away, bring a new one. Oh, no, wait, that doesn't work. Because the bridge being narrow, if you put a crane on there, you can't swing the boom. It'll hit the cables. And conversely, the counterweight on the other side of the crane will hit the cable on the other side. So using a crane isn't such a good idea. And there are further restraints. We were only allowed to occupy it for 10 hours at night. And during those 10 hours, there had to be a facility for a stretcher to get across because there was a hospital on one side but not the other. So it was somewhat constrained. So the solution that we came up with was this shown diagrammatically. This is like two vehicles sitting on the deck, and they're carrying, I think I've got a pointer here. Okay, so there's a big beam, and this is the bit that's going to go in, the new bit. This is the bit that's going to come out, and this is a temporary infill. Okay, so we back or forward, which depends which way you're pointing, this vehicle onto the bridge, lift out the temporary piece, lift out the old piece that's coming out, move it along, put down the new piece, put down the temporary piece, drive the truck off, and wait until tomorrow night to do the next one. And just as a matter of interest, that's a view from underneath that vehicle that's not quite so stylized. It's fairly real. It was tricky because the gap between the tower legs to get this through gave us a clearance of, I can't remember what it was an inch and a half or something. So for a big thing like that, it was tricky, but it worked. So we've got the deck replacement, but there was another problem, which is that the stiffening truss, by any modern standards, was grossly overloaded. And the ministry wanted to increase the capacity of the bridge from 13.5-ton vehicle to 2 55-ton vehicles, which you might think is a bit of an increase. It's not quite as bad as it sounds because the bigger trucks are more, well, the longer and more spread out, and that's good for a suspension bridge. But still, it's a pretty big increase. So how to do that? Well, as it turned out, the thing to do, we thought, I'll show this diagrammatically. If you could look at the top picture, that's kind of the deck as it was, supported by the hangers that wrap around the main cables. And the idea was to shorten those carefully so the bridge was bent upwards. The stiffening truss that the things run on was bent upwards, forced upwards, tension on the top, compression on the bottom. Then, you look at the bottom picture, see, when a truck comes on, it pushes it down to where it was, which is already taking quite a bit of load now, and then beyond. And that way, you can increase the capacity. So here you see a detail of what we call the hanger or suspender ropes that wrap up over the main cable towers, main bridge cables. And you can see, fortunately, they were connected to a forged rod with threads on it. And so by pulling down and moving the nuts up, you could actually shorten it. In fact, this one is shortened so much that they've had to cut the flange off the transverse beam, and they put a new flange in down here. But this went on up and down the bridge sequentially until we'd got it to where we wanted it to get. The net result of that being that this is before we did the thing. Now, I don't want to fool you too much with graphs, but on the left, we have the tower. This is at the tower. This is at the middle of the bridge. This dashed line is the capacity. And the actual load, as you can see, was higher than its capacity. That was the thing everybody was worried about, because when capacity exceeds the load, it falls down or something like that. After we'd done that, it's the wrong one again, the capacity stayed the same. But because we'd pre-stressed, if you like, these hangars, the demand went down. So the net result was that we increased the capacity from 113.5-ton truck to 255-ton trucks, and here's the key thing, without any strengthening. So that was kind of neat. It's not very easy to strengthen a suspension bridge, so that was a big plus. And as we go on, the towers were another issue, because nowadays our estimate of the wind forces is that they're greater than what the bridge was designed for. And it hadn't blown down. It was built in 1932, and so it was still there. And that's good, but it didn't have the current safety standards. So there's a look at the tower. Interesting, you see a bit of rust there. The bridge hasn't been painted since 1932, and there's graffiti in it from 1934. Unfortunately, they're going to paint it this summer and ruin the graffiti. But there, it's probably good for it. All right, so there's the tower. Doesn't look very elegant, but it works. And on the left here, this is very diagrammatic. On the left, you see the bridge as it was. And what we have is the two tower legs here and here. This is the deck system here with its supporting trusses underneath. And the wind force was taken out at deck level. This puts bending in this long leg. And this diagram here is what we call a bending diagram, which shows the amount of bending force in it, which is quite considerable. And you can see that if you've got a long, thin strut, the last thing you want to do is start bending it in the middle, because they tend to buckle, if you've noticed. So what we did do was change that arrangement from taking the wind force out here to taking it out here. And that meant that the bending in the leg of the tower was practically zero, just a little bit of bending down here. So again, we've increased the capacity quite considerably just by altering the load path. Again, no strengthening. So this was kind of neat. And so we move on. So I promised you I'd talk a bit about Lionsgate. And I apologize if you've heard this before, because I know I have talked about it before. But I still think it's one of the most interesting jobs that I've ever done. And I also think that it fulfills the requirements for tonight. So it's in two parts, suspension bridge on the south end and an approach viaduct on the north end. And we deal first with the north end. The other point I should say is my career has been fairly long by most people's standards. We're talking more than half a century now. And in that time, lots of interesting things have happened. So if I'm showing you a slide that looks old, the reason is that it is old. But I think the principles apply just as much now as they did then. So we're going to start with the North Viaduct, which was some time back. As was mentioned, it's actually when we formed a company. So it's a long viaduct with a lot of legs, a lot tall and thin. And the basic problem with it was the concrete roadway deck was falling apart. Concrete, as most of you know, because I know I've got a mixed audience here, so if I'm telling you things you already know, forgive me. The concrete tends to crack, no matter what you do. And water gets into the little cracks. And after they started putting de-icing salts on the bridge in 1955, the icing salts got into the little cracks, and that's even worse. What it does is it goes down, attacks the reinforcing steel, makes the reinforcing steel rust. Rust occupies a much bigger volume than the steel it comes from, like up to 10 times. So it's trying to expand, and eventually it pops up a little bit of concrete and exposes it, and now the rust can really get going. And so that's what's been happening here. They were fixing up to 1,000 potholes a year on this bridge. And as you can see, they've used many different materials, and you can also see that they obviously don't work very well. Those keys are just for scale. Okay, so that's the problem. Now, this is a cross-section of the bridge. Oh, sorry, I've got a multi-button thing here, and it's a bit beyond my capacity. Yeah. Okay, so there's a plate girder there and a plate girder there, and those two support these transverse girders at fairly close intervals, and they in turn support the concrete deck and sidewalk, for that matter. A bit narrow, but it worked. So now, the problem is that the bridge is very busy, and one of the rules were it must be kept open to daytime traffic. And in fact, we were given 6 hours at night. In the end, we relaxed that to 6.5. 6.5 hours to do whatever you've got to do. Now, imagine you've got to jackhammer out the concrete, put in some formwork underneath, place some rebar, pour some concrete, and have that hardened enough, ready to take traffic with full strength or enough strength in 6 hours' time. So it's a bit of a tall order. And in fact, the ministry had been putting off doing anything because they couldn't really quite figure out how to do this. So it needed, obviously, a bit of lateral thinking, rather literally lateral, as I'll explain. The plan we came up with was to sever the rivets here that connect the transverse beams to the main girders, here and here, cut through the concrete deck in slices, transverse slices, that's the lateral bit, and then lift a piece out and replace it with a wider, what we call orthotropic steel deck. And what that is a big steel plate, basically, all the way over, stiffened by bent plates underneath, which we call troughs, and in the manner more or less of corrugated cardboard. It's the same principle, really. And would put proper paving on so that next time the paving wears out, you just replace the paving, not the whole deck. They have a few other benefits, too. One is it would be a solid barrier between the pedestrians and the traffic, and everything was a bit wider, which was comfortable. Oh, it also had proper drains, which never had before. And that was another problem. So here's how it happened. That's the orthotropic steel deck being fabricated upside down. It's much easier to do it upside down. You can see the troughs and the transverse beams and so on. When the panels were made, they were turned the right way up, joined together, taken off to site. On site, there's this huge, what we call a ringer crane, which, without going into detail, is a big crane. It's got a 100-meter-long boom, and it could pick up a full piece. And there you see it moving. It's in the daytime, so this is obviously not replacing. But you can just about make out the whole deck piece, which, So it's got the paving on, you can see the barriers, you can see the lamp standard on, the handrails and everything all ready to go up. So that's going to go up at night. You can also see on the bridge, it's been widened up to here. So obviously this is tonight's piece in here. And actually, because the new bridge was not only wider, but it was also lighter than what came out, the crane had to take the old bit out in two pieces, two little pieces, and put in one big piece. So there's a piece coming out. It's been cut through. And then as soon as it was out, it wasn't, you couldn't go right away. The steel girders that the new panel was going to sit on had to be cleaned up, leveled, painted with a paint that would cure even if it was raining, which in Vancouver, it could do. You can see here, I need another finger. So this is where it was cut through, the old deck. This actually is a spreader beam, which you can barely see in the dark here, but it's to, there's another one over here, to lift out the next piece, which is coming out shortly. They were about 6 meters long each. And here you can see a chap cutting through the deck with a diamond saw for the next night or the night after or something like that. We had some interesting times here because the bridge obviously was closed to traffic, but that didn't prevent all the excitement. There was a case of a chap who was fairly well into his cups, I'd say, walking down the bridge from the other end, not very steady on his feet, got to the edge, looked down, stepped down onto the flange of the girder, which is only a long way down, but it's about that wide, with a lot of rivet heads on it, walked across dead straight, and then climbed up and lurched off into West Vancouver. So there are a few little things like that to put up with. So it was not entirely dull. Here's the last piece going in, a little bit narrower than the others because it has to fit inside the cables of the suspension bridge, and then the sidewalk was tacked on afterwards, but you can see the idea. And then in the morning, it was open for traffic at 6 o'clock almost every morning. The first one and the last one were late because they were the most difficult ones, but everything else was on time. And as you can see, the cars aren't quite modern because it was a while ago. But it was the first time that was done, as far as I know, and it was done later on many other bridges, including Golden Gate and Champlain and Throgs Neck in New York and various others. Okay, so enough for that. Then we turned our attention to the main suspension bridge. And here, this got interesting too. So what was the problem? The problem was in several parts. The deck is very thin, 75 millimeters or 3 inches for the older ones, made of a sort of a bunch of T-grids. There's T's on their back with the stem sticking up. And then actually there were bars welded across. And what you can see there is mostly the bars that run longitudinally. then that was filled with concrete. So it's very small, and it had no paving, and it had no allowance to carry paving. And a typical paving on a bridge is 2 inches, or 50 millimeters, so you can see compared to the 75 millimeter deck, that's a large increase. And the trouble is that the bars got to be very slippery. And so they tried patching it with a very thin paving. It had to be thin because of weight. And it didn't work very well, as you can see. So there's problem number one. Problem number two is that the lanes were really too narrow. It was designed as a two-lane bridge, but carrying three. The sidewalks were narrow and exposed to the traffic. You can see a couple of pedestrians there, and you can see that that might be dangerous with a bus driving by with a wing mirror. Another problem, there's no drains. The water just runs off the side. And maybe that was okay when it opened to traffic in 1938, but in 1955 they started putting salt down. Salt mixes with the water and causes a lot of corrosion underneath. And finally, if that's not enough, the stiffening trusses that run down the side, which are what sort of spread the load out, were somewhat overloaded by modern standards. And there were other things that were interesting we'll get to. So there we go. So we said, first of all, we have to know what the state of the bridge is. The question we had actually was, can you put 50 millimeters of paving on it? And we said, well, that seems like a lot. Maybe. But we don't know anything about the bridge. So the first thing we better do is examine the condition of the bridge. And I think we invented, I've never heard of anyone else doing it, what we call the survey and analyze method. Or sometimes we call it the survey and analysis, or sometimes we call it analysis and survey, but it's, you know, get the idea. So what do? We model in the computer the bridge as it was built. If we know that, if we have records, if we don't, we do it as designed and hope that it was close to that. Then we model the changes that have happened since then. So for example, you might have added weight, you might have added members, you might have changed this, changed that, and we incorporate those all into the model. Now, suspension bridges have the advantage of being very sensitive. The shape of the suspension bridge is very sensitive to whatever's happening to it. And so you can detect small changes quite well. Then we go out and survey the bridge to see where everything is. And it's very sensitive to temperature, so we correct that for temperature. And now we've got a temperature-corrected survey, and we've got the model in the computer. And now, by now, they're the same. Well, actually, they've never ever been the same in more than 20 bridges. I think we've done about 25 suspension bridges now, and they're never the same. So what's the problem? And that's where the detective work starts, and it begins to get interesting. So let me give you this example. The dashed white lines are where the bridge should be, according to our analysis. The orange lines are where it actually is, according to the survey. In this case, which was Lions Gate, there had been some weight added. We knew that. Given order of magnitude, that's about a meter. It was about a meter lower than it should be in the middle. So it's really quite detectable. The towers were leaning in. The bridge had gone down. And the question was why. So some weight had been added. The tower on the north side had settled. It was expected to settle and was actually built a little bit high, but it went down past where it was meant to be and got to be a bit lower. And though all these effects that we knew about explained about half the discrepancy, but you still got half a meter to explain somehow. And so we scratched our heads and came with the idea that what must have happened is that the main cables have stretched. They're not meant to stretch. No one had ever reported stretch. But it turns out that certain forms of cable, spiral wound cable, do stretch, even though you do everything you can to prevent that when you build the bridge. And some people said to us, don't be silly, we know that doesn't happen. But we've found other examples since, so we know that it can happen. So once we modeled that, we got very good agreement between the computer and what we saw. Now, we know the difference between what should be and what is, and now we can tell whether or not it's serious and what we have to do about it. One of the things I mentioned was temperature. So we looked at the temperature. Here we have temperature over a period of time, from 8 o'clock one morning through to 9 o'clock, 10 o'clock the next morning. And this is temperature up here in degrees Celsius. So the different parts of the bridge are all changing in the heat of the afternoon. They're all over the place. And for comparison, this is the ambient temperature on continuous recording. Conventional, we knew this, really. So conventional wisdom that if you want to survey a suspension bridge, you've got to do it between midnight and 2 o'clock in the morning when the temperatures are all the same. But you can see that between midnight and 2 o'clock in the morning, they're not all the same. Well, they're close, actually, but they're all also changing very rapidly. And the temperature doesn't really level off until sort of 4 o'clock, 6 o'clock, something like that, which was something that really wasn't known. The other interesting thing is that the bridge was still cooling while the ambient temperature was actually increasing in the morning. And that did seem weird. And we talked to the climate people, and they said, well, everybody knows that. That's why you get frost on the grass when it isn't, when it's above 0 degrees at night, and frost on your windshield in the same condition. It's radiant cooling that cools the structure down below the ambient temperature, which is why also we like to do our surveys with a cloud cover, not just at night and no wind, but with a cloud cover, because it reduces that radiant cooling. So that's a bit technical, but it was all interesting. So now, we start off with what we call the cable, the cable bend. This is the longest of the supports, and it has a triple function. It supports the cable where it bends down to go to the anchorage. It supports the end of the side span, and it supports the end of the last span of the approach viaduct. And what we found was interesting. In our survey, well, let's back up. When they built the bridge, they found that this saddle here, which was meant to be clamped to the cable, was in fact slipping slightly. So they hastily did some remedial repairs and put this collar on to stop it sliding any further. It clamps the cable. When we surveyed it, it had clearly moved more than that, another 2 or 3 inches. And what is interesting, if you see this gray there on just behind the saddle, one of what is now, I suppose, our competitors in a big New York company came and looked at this. They unwrapped the cable. They noticed that there was a 2-inch gap there. Thought, well, we'd better put something in to fill the gap, and wrapped it up and went away without realizing that this is actually very significant. Because, well, the first thing we did was put tie backs on, some cables to pull it back to increase the safety factor against sliding. We didn't know if it was sliding a few molecules a year or whether it had one dramatic thing that had caused it to slide. We didn't know. But clearly, the safety factor against slipping was too close to one to be comfortable. So by adding the cables, that was stopped. So now diagrammatically, and to a very exaggerated scale, the cable bent should be where the vertical white line is. But because the cable has stretched on the right-hand side, and because it has slipped up the cable anyway, the top is now where the red line is. Not that much, it's exaggerated, but shows the point. And just to make life interesting, the bottom had rotated in the opposite direction, which is not what you would expect, but it was presumably because of some weak soil under one side. So now we've got a very bent bent. It's an appropriate expression for that thing. And as we mentioned earlier, long, thin struts don't do very well if you add a lot of bending to them. And the thing was rather alarmingly overstressed, hadn't fallen down. So what to do? Well, put it back. Yeah, sure. So can you imagine how you would do that? You've got to somehow lift the main cable, which is a huge thing with an enormous tension in it, and bring the top of the cable bent back and somehow put it down again. And when you pick it up, you've got to be able to accommodate the daily temperature. It, as it gets hot and cold, it moves. And then at the bottom, I suppose you'd have to jack that up somehow and straighten that out. It all got a bit worrying. So what we decided to do in the end was not to do either of those things. I was not at all sure that we could pull the top back, and didn't like the idea of jacking up the foundations either. If you can imagine the foundations sitting on jacks and you get a minor earthquake, that would be the end of the Lionsgate Bridge. Might have been good for business, but not for me. So what we decided to do instead was to hinge the bottom just to let it straighten out if it wanted to straighten out. There was just a possibility that it was built bent, and therefore straightening it out would actually make it worse. But the idea was we straighten it out so it would be straight, but it no longer be vertical. But it's only a few inches, a few centimeters out. question was how to do that, because I didn't like the idea of jacking it up and putting it down. So here's what we did. This is a diagrammatic view of the bottom, the foundation of this animal, tilted a little bit to the right. It's just mass concrete. And the bit on the, go back one. The bit on the top is the steel structure, and this is all concrete, and the brown is all soil. Okay, so first thing was to excavate a little bit around it, and then drive in piles, which are the two vertical dashed lines, drive them into the ground, pipe piles. Then pour a collar of concrete around the bottom and stress it with cables in both directions to make it integral with the lump of concrete. Then cut a hole through the middle. Now, we've cut a hole, but the load is still coming down through the mass concrete as it always was. None of this stuff's taking any load. The load path is still the same, other than it has to go around the hole. Then inside the hole, we put sort of a knuckle joint, like a hinge, but it basically is something that can rotate thus, and push it up tight to the top of the hole so that it is tight. We don't want any gaps in there. Then pour a second collar around the top and stress that. And still the load is going where it was through the mass concrete. We put jacks between the top collar and the bottom collar at each end. And then, here's the key thing, we cut through the concrete. And so that the load now is necessarily transferred to the rocker bearing in the middle and the jacks on the outside, because the rest of it's gone. Then connect the jacks on the left to the jacks on the right and open up the tap so that oil can flow from one to the other, so it's still supported on three points, but it's free to rotate if it wants to, which it did. So you get that. And then we take the jacks out, and now the load is all going down through that hinge. And so if it wants to slip any more, it can do so, and either way, it's straightened itself out. In looking at it, what actually happened, here's the mass concrete footing. The little dots that you see on it are for ultrasonic testing to make sure that we've got solid concrete in there, because if it was poor concrete, we would obviously have a problem with this. It was okay. Now they've dug a hole around it, driven the pipe piles into the ground, like there, roughened up the concrete to attach the collar to it. There's the collar with the reinforcing steel. There is a problem, of course, that concrete shrinks, which is why it cracks. So the ring around this wants to shrink, but it can't because it's got this 30, 40-year-old concrete there objecting to it. So it has to have a lot of steel, and I used a low-shrink concrete to minimize this effect. And you can also see the holes drilled through the top for taking the tendons for the top collar. Now we poured the bottom collar and drilled the hole in the side. And here's the knuckle joint itself, just about to be slid into the hole. There is a grillage at top and bottom, but the real joint is just there. The idea of the grillages was they'd be filled with concrete so they'd make it, spread the load out generally. Inside the hole were two rails that the bearing slid in on, and underneath them are six jacks, and they were not operated by oil, they're operated by water. And so when the thing was in the hole, the top was poured, and then the jacks would push it up into the lid, like this. So there's the top grillage filled with concrete, and now the jacks are activated, and they push it up, and you can see there, the bottom bit has been poured. These turnbuckles can now be cut off and taken away. They were just to stop it falling over. There's a pressure gauge here to make sure that the pressure is maintained on the jacks, although by this point it's getting a bit late. They were flushed out and filled with cement grout in the end, so that they are actually carrying some load. And then this you see cutting through. I think you can see it. Anyway, here's a close-up. And this is rather remarkable. The guys, have you ever tried drilling holes? It's really very, very difficult to drill them close together. These concrete corers can make them overlap. And this these holes here, which were sequential, were coming from the other side, which was 3 meters away. I think that's absolutely astonishing accuracy for coming from 3 meters on the other side. Really quite amazing. So there it is, sitting on its jacks. And then when we allowed it to rotate, it did. And that was, we only closed it once, one Sunday morning, just to calm our nerves in case anything went wrong. And there it is in its final condition. And you can see that it has opened up on the right-hand side and closed on the left-hand side, so it did want to rotate, and it did. And it lasted that way for a long time, never showed any distress or any further movement. And in a more recent go-round, actually, that was all filled in again for improved earthquake resistance. So, but anyway, this is where we end this bit of story. So now, back to the basic problem of the bridge. You remember what I told you about that, and if you don't, we'll move on. One of the things that was interesting was it was designed for very light loading, suspiciously light loading, and that worried us quite a bit. So we decided we'd better see if we could figure out what the loading actually is, and really very little was known about the loading on a long span bridge. We all know that if you've got a small bridge, the maximum load it will ever get is probably the heaviest truck. We actually don't know what the heaviest truck is, but if you did know, you'd know that's the loading. But as you get longer and longer lengths, you're going to get cars and empty trucks and other things, buses in the traffic stream. So the average loading is going to go down as the length of loading goes up. So that's a nice philosophical point, but you still don't know what it actually is. So we set out to try and find out. So part of what we did was to photograph the traffic from one of the towers. You can see the tripod there on the left. It was very low tech by today's standards. We took a frame, I think, every 5 seconds or something like that. We'd marked out 50 and 100 foot intervals on the sidewalks. You can see the white marks there. And hung a clock out there with a huge face because it was pretty well out of focus. And so you wouldn't know the time of day. We had to have a big clock. Anyway, we persevered. And when, I think in the end, we were fairly successful. So now, what we've got here is what the bridge was. This is the average loading. Right? You don't need to know what the numbers are, but this is, as you go up, it's heavier loading. And this is the amount of bridge that is loaded in meters. So the longer you get, the less you would expect the average load to be. What the bridge was designed for was actually this load here. And certain parts of it were designed for what they called the congested load, which is this line. If you take the current code at that time, which in BC we were still using the American code then, and take the average load on what the code tells it should be, this is what we get. Now, that, it's called the AASHTO code, sort of sneeze. But AASHTO doesn't claim to be relevant for more than 150 meters. But still, if you extrapolate it, then you come on down here. Either way, it's an awful lot more than that. And that was a bit of a bother. So we thought we'd better try and investigate this. What we found was this. It took a while. What we actually saw in terms of the average loading with what we measured, it was this line here. But the government was threatening to triple the number of buses. So we reran our simulations with three times the number of buses and came up with the top orange line. We said, well, okay, well, that's maybe what it should be. So what does that actually mean? The cables and the cable bent that we just looked at and the anchorages, they get their maximum loading when everything's loaded from one end of the bridge to the other, so a long load. And at that point, actually, it's not too bad. I've left a bit out here. While we were getting worried about it, we suggested that they ban trucks until we'd sorted this out. So they did ban trucks, and they found the traffic flow increased so much that they never allowed trucks back on again. So this is the truckless traffic. So since it had been running with trucks for a long time, it probably had been overloaded here. The towers are governed by the main span loaded. If I'm looking at this tower, it's the main span to the other tower and the far span that gives a worse condition here. So they're slightly shorter loaded length, but not a huge difference. But the stiffening trusses that we looked at down the side of the road, they're in this range, and here, the loading that could potentially be on the bridge is a lot more than it was designed for, which was down here. So although the loading was a lot more, the actual effect on the bridge was still unsatisfactory, but not as bad as it looks. Anyway, this was part of the research bit that I was talking about. Another thing we looked at was aerodynamics. And you will probably all realize that was so-called Galloping Gertie, the Tacoma Narrows Bridge. And one of the things that we've got two distinguished aerodynamicists here tonight, Gila Rose and Bob Wardlaw. And if you get them in a corner, they'll tell you this is not a good thing to happen. And so we wanted to make sure that it didn't. Lionsgate was built before this happened. So the knowledge that was gained from Tacoma Narrows investigation and after was not available when the bridge was built, but it is available to us now. So we're trying to prevent this from happening. What do we know? We know that the aerodynamic behavior of the bridge is sensitive to a number of things. One is the natural frequency of the bridge. In general terms, the higher the frequency, the better. Although as the bridge gets longer, the frequency tends to go down. So you get a bit of a problem. But it is a function of the natural frequency. It's also a function of damping, which is to say, if you set the bridge going in motion, it'll gradually damp down. And the energy input from the wind isn't all that great, usually. And so if you've got a fair bit of damping, you can maybe compensate. But if you don't have enough, you get a problem. And the other thing it sends to is the center of rotation, which I'll explain in a minute. Don't worry about it. It is there. So we thought we'd start by measuring structural damping. We didn't need to measure the frequency because we can calculate that. So that was OK. But we didn't know much about the structural damping. If you did move the bridge, what would it do? So we thought we'd look at that. And what we did was put an accelerometer. You can see that thing sitting up there on the steel. And then we took a truck out one night when it was closed for work on the viaduct and filled it up with damp, wet sand, dump truck, put it on some timbers, ran it off the timbers. It was a great thunk. And the bridge did whatever it did. And it was recorded by this marvelous device. And you can see that the damping, you know, the bridge motion damps down. It's also a bit squiggly. But if you filter it out electronically, you can get a better curve for one particular frequency. And you can see very clearly how the damping is, at least for that experiment. As a byproduct, you can also see what the natural frequency is, because you know how regular these intervals are. And you can tell what the period is from one point back to the same point, which was interesting because it wasn't what we'd calculated. So what we thought we knew turned out not to be right. So obviously, the instruments are wrong, because I'm not. So one night, there was this funny frame in the middle of the bridge. So we dropped a bucket of about, I don't know, several hundred pounds of steel from the middle of the thing when the bridge was closed and rocked this from side to side and gradually lengthened the pendulum until we got resonance with the bridge. And at that point, as the bucket of weights was swinging left and right across the roadway, the bridge was going like this. The critical condition was one side down and one side up, as you actually saw on Tacoma. And you could stand there and watch that handrail going up and down and time it with your watch. I mean, this was not rocket science. What it also wasn't was the same as what we'd calculated. So that gave us an interesting situation. First of all, we had our calculations. And we thought, given the circumstances, we'd better get them checked. So they were checked by a totally different method, totally different data, using a stiffness matrix, which we hadn't used, by Hooley Engineering. And Hooley confirmed our calculations totally. That's good. Then we've got the electronic measurement, which didn't agree. And we've got the physical measurement, which agreed with the electronic. So the top two didn't agree with the bottom two. And we began to think that life was getting interesting. So what was happening? There is a mode, what we call a mode shape. So you have here the abutment. This is the side span. That's the tower. That's the middle of the main span, and same on the other side. The green motion is some part of the bridge, the bottom right-hand corner, actually, going up and down. So up on the left, down on the right. The white dashed line is the sideways motion. So it's going one way and then the other way. So if we look at the side span, for example, we know it's going up and we know it's going sideways. So actually that thing is doing this, right? And the frequency is 0.3 hertz. OK, so that's what we calculated. What we observed was these little diamonds and circles from which we extrapolated the rest. You can see that the main span here is pretty similar. But the side span isn't. First of all, the amplitude's much lower. And in the main span, the sideways motion has changed to go the other direction. So instead of going this way, it's going that way. And the numbers don't add up. They're not the same. They're different by nearly 20%, which is a problem, maybe. So here's what was happening. I won't go through the whole story, but I'll tell you what the result was. This is a cross-section of the bridge. So you have the two cables here and here. There were hangers, hanger ropes that went over, and they had rungs on for maintenance. They're not very useful. Then the two stiffening trusses, one here and similar on the other side. Floor beams running across, longitudinal beams, which we call stringers, at close intervals there, and this deck on top, that we the thin 75 millimeter grid deck. In the roadway, back up one for the engineers here. The roadway is not in the middle of the truss level. It's not at the neutral axis of the truss. So it's going as the truss bends, the roadway is going to want to pick up some load, some stress. To get around that, the designers had put what we call breather joints. You see one here, it runs across the bridge. And the idea was just to let them go a bit so they wouldn't try and participate with the trusses and cause some sort of trouble. So going back to here, what was actually happening was that the breather joints were not breathing. They weren't moving at the low amplitudes we were measuring anyway. The friction wasn't overcome. So we have the trusses here and here. We have lateral bracing in the bottom plane here. And we have this big plate-like diaphragm here, which was doing several things. It was adding a bit to the stiffness of the trusses vertically. It was acting as a lateral thing. And that motion that I showed you is combined lateral and vertical all the time, so it's torsional. And it was also forming some kind of a torsionally stiff box, a wide, thin box like that, which is torsionally very stiff indeed. And that was what was pushing up the torsional frequency, mainly. There were a few other effects, too, but those are the main ones. So now when we could model some of that, we get a little bit closer. And this is actually a slightly different mode shape, but the one at the top is what we calculated. The one at the bottom is what we observed. Not quite the same frequency, but look, they do now look much the same. So we had, after about a year, I might say, finally nailed down what was causing this to be not what we expected. All right, moving on. So we know about the natural frequencies now, and we've learned something about the damping. And now we come to this center of rotation thing. Traditionally, ever since Tacoma Narrows, it's very expensive to build a full model of the bridge in the wind tunnel. You need a very big wind tunnel, for one thing. So what these aerodynamicist chaps do is they take a bit of the bridge, make a rigid model of that, and mount it on springs so that it goes up and down just as it would if it were part of the bridge, right? So you've just got this little bit going up and down. It's much more economical, and you can play with it a lot more, and you get a much bigger scale for the same size wind tunnel. So what this is showing is this is a section of bridge, not Lionsgate, but some section. This is the wind tunnel cut away. And this is mounted on spindles. And there's a sort of a cross piece at the end with springs top and bottom, so that the piece in the wind tunnel will vibrate up and down or torsionally with the right frequencies and the right ratio of these frequencies and the right modeling for the mass and so on. And then you blow on it and see what happens. The problem is, where do you mount this spindle? For most bridges, it's not a problem. For Lionsgate, it was a bit of a dilemma. So here's the cross-section again. And some people thought that, well, this is all rigid. this is not rigid, because it's just a cable. So you better mount it with the pivot point, the spindle being about there. Some people thought, well, it should be at the center of gravity of this piece, which is about at deck level in the middle there. And some of the more advanced people thought, well, this is actually like a channel on its side. And a channel on its side has a shear center, which is the point at which, if you push it sideways, it won't rotate. And that is down here somewhere. So should we be mounting that spindle here, or here, or here, or somewhere else? And does it make any difference anyway? So Bob and his crowd at National Research Council looked into it. So I won't go too much into this. What this is the this is the torsional to vertical frequency ratio. It's very important that the ratio between the torsional and the vertical be separated, because when they get close to a ratio of one, the same, the thing goes very unstable. And actually, you can see that when you get down to a ratio of one, the stability dropped right off. As we increase the frequency ratio, this is the velocity at which it goes unstable. Don't worry about that, but it's a dimensionless number. But basically, further up is a faster wind speed, and you want it to go as high a wind speed as you can. So by changing the frequency ratio up to around 1.5, 2, or a bit more, you're much higher than being down here somewhere, higher wind speed. That's with the thing mounted at the center of gravity. Then, if you don't mount it there, you mount it either above or below, and the triangles are mounted more or less at that top point that I mentioned between the hangers, and the other one with the square is down near where the shear center is, both of which are about 3.5 meters above or below the deck. It gets to be very much more stable. The wind speed at which it goes unstable has increased here dramatically. So it is important. And what's the answer? Well, now here's the test. What we find is, again, this is the abutment, this is the tower, this is the middle of the bridge, this is the center of gravity, which is at more or less at deck level in the middle. And for what it's worth, this is the lower chord. It doesn't matter. This is the shear center, which, as I said, is the point below the deck at which, if you push sideways, it won't rotate. And the actual point at which it rotated, this is a computer simulation, but if you put it in the computer, you can see how it moves. The first symmetric mode, which means it's the same this side as this side, the where the actual center of rotation is on the bridge varies from way up here to down around near where the center of gravity is on the main span. And on the side span, it's way down below. So there is no one point. And not only that, but it varies a heck of a lot. And for the first anti-symmetric mode, you see again, it's different again. So there's no one point at which you should mount the section model. So Peter Irwin, who at that time was working for Bob Wardlaw, came up with a formula. You don't need to know what it means, but it's a formula that gave an equivalent. And when we tested that, we got good agreement with the full model. You don't need to know it. Remember it, though. It's on the test at the end of the lecture. OK, so now we know the center of natural frequency is damping, the center of rotation, and turbulence, which we hadn't mentioned before. And it was Alan Davenport, who at the University of Western Ontario promoted the idea that turbulence in the wind is important, because all of the wind tunnel testing that had been done since Tacoma on, I think all, most, I might be the cheering crowd down here might correct me, but people with wind tunnels took enormous pains to have uniform wind, smooth flow all across the cross-sectional chamber. And Alan Davenport said, that's not right. And so Bob Wardlaw took this up and we looked at this with respect to Lionsgate Bridge. Allen's wind tunnel was very small, and there was some concern that because it was small, we were getting scaling effects. The agreement between the section model and the full model that Davenport had wasn't all that great. So Bob thought it might be to do with scaling. So we built a bigger mousetrap. So here we are in the 9-meter tunnel at here near the airport, which is run by the National Research Council. And now we have a much bigger model of the bridge. That's Glenn Schuyler, if anybody's interested, who now works for RWDI, but then worked for Bob. And there's a model of the old bridge, actually, that one. The funny cylinder things you see do look a bit odd, but they simulate the cables. There's a real difficulty when you scale down from the real bridge down to this kind of model. You can't scale everything you want at the same rate, so that the dimension and the mass and the drag and so on, they all scale differently. So you have to fiddle a little bit with that. And that's the art of the model making. And so what those cylinders are literally just to give a bit more mass and a bit more drag to make it all realistic. So anyway, that's the model. Now, this is a bit hard to see, and I apologize, but this is in the wind tunnel, same model, and the wind is coming towards us. And to make the turbulence, we have these blocks and spires. Now, real wind, as it goes across the surface of the Earth, the surface of the Earth is rough. And so it causes turbulence, more or less at ground level, you might say, and slows the wind down. So the higher you go, conversely, it gets faster, but less turbulent. And this combination of the blocks and the spires produced the amount of turbulence that was realistic. This device is just measuring the wind speed. It's downstream of the bridge, so it doesn't affect the airflow. You'll see in a minute, these little things here are not supporting the bridge either and not doing much for the wind flow. So there we were. That's just a view up, a view from underneath of the new bridge, actually, before we changed it, different model. And those devices here are just measuring motion of the bridge, and they don't do anything else. So what do we get? OK. So this is wind speed along the bottom, which is, again, one of these non-dimensional parameters. But by coincidence, it was very close. If you multiply it by 10, it was very close to miles an hour. And up this side, we have the motion, the torsional motion up and down in degrees. When we do the section model, now mounted at its correct place in accordance with that formula you all remembered, we get this vertical dashed line. And then when we test the full model in smooth flow, practically nothing happens until the wind speed builds up to near the critical velocity, and then all of a sudden it goes unstable. So very sensitive. What happens if we test in turbulent flow is this. We get more buildup of motion at the low wind speeds caused by the buffeting. But we've gone right through the apparent level of instability without going unstable. It's just increased. And if we look across here at 1 degree, which is not very much, that's occurring at a wind speed of about 120 miles an hour, which for Vancouver was OK, and a good deal more than the sort of 93 that would be predicted by the section model test. So it was an expensive test, but well worth it, because it saved an enormous amount of extra cost. OK, so that's some of the research background, because we wanted to get some research in here. Now we'll get to what actually happened. What are we going to do with the suspension bridge? So what we're trying to do is to replace the corroded deck. If you remember, that's actually a view from underneath. I didn't show this before, but you can see the flat part of the T's. They're tack welded together. There's all sorts of corrosion. This down here is a beam, a longitudinal beam stringer. There's a lot of corrosion here. These T's were welded down to it, but that rust expands and breaks the welds. So they would come out and weld it up again, and that would last a matter of weeks, and it would break again. So there were problems there. So we want to fix that. Traffic lanes were too wide, view from above. But they, believe me, they weren't wide enough. We want to provide barriers between the pedestrians and the cyclists, pedestrians and the cars, because they really were too close for any overhanging load. I've had, actually, I was out one night, and all of a sudden my boots were on fire. And what it wasn't actually that. What had happened was a vehicle coming close right beside me had hit the curb. It's a metal curb, and the metal wheel hub had hit the curb, and there's all these sparks went across my boot. But just for that microsecond there, I don't know what had happened. So it was too close for comfort. We want to provide proper paving so that we don't have this wear out stuff again. And we want to provide drains so that we don't just get the salty water dribbling over the edge. And the paving is a bit of an issue because, as I said, it's an increase of thickness of the deck from about 75 millimeters to 125. Which is a big increase in the heaviest part of the bridge. And we want to reduce maintenance. What was happening is the salt was getting into these little crevices between rivets. This is a riveted structure. The salt gets in there, the wet salt, and makes it rusty. You get a dry day. We have them in Vancouver as well. And the water evaporates but leaves the salt inside. In the summer, you get nice warm rains coming. They go down there, they get into the crevice, they mix with the salt, but now they're warm, and the corrosion goes nice and fast. And it wasn't that big an issue, but the bridge always had a bit of a hump in the middle. It was built of straight sections, and that was very noticeable in the middle of the bridge, and we thought we'd like to get rid of that as well. Also, as I mentioned, it didn't really have the load capacity for modern traffic, so we would like to increase that if we can. Actually, it didn't even have the load capacity for the traffic, the load carrying capacity for the load that it already had, even with the trucks missing. And this is the sequel to the last picture on Tacoma Narrows, and we're hoping to avoid that too. However, there were some constraints. First of all, whatever we did, it was going to hang off the same cables, the same towers, the same anchorages, so we wanted to keep the weight the same, otherwise they would be a problem. Again, it had to be open for daily traffic, so whatever happened had to happen with the traffic flowing during the daytime. That meant we were given 10 hours each night from 8 o'clock at night to 6 o'clock in the morning, and whatever had to happen in that period. Now, if you get a normal construction project, there's usually one deadline, which is opening day, and you know how often they don't occur on time. Here, the contractor has to be ready to move in with all his equipment and everything at 8 o'clock. Everything that needed to be done during the daytime has to have been done. And he's got to be ready to move off and take down the barriers for traffic at 6 o'clock the next morning. So not only has he got one deadline, he's got many, many deadlines. And it's very demanding from a management point of view. Also, the access was very limited. The bridge is built on a narrow strip, I can't remember the exact dimensions, that runs through a park on the south side, which is untouchable, and runs through an Indian reserve on the other side, which is equally untouchable. So it was very difficult space. So the decision was that the way to fix this is not just to do the deck, but take out the whole thing that's hanging off the cables and replace it. So there's the cross-section that we've seen before with the trusses up above the deck here, hanging off the cable. So we're going to take all of that out and actually replace the hangers. So just leave the cable there. And replace that with this, which is, again, an orthotropic steel deck plate with paving, with barriers, with drains that aren't shown here, but the drains are under here and they would duck down. The stiffening truss that was up the side here has gone down to below. So this is the top, this whole plate actually is the top cord of the stiffening truss. And there's a new cord down here, shallower than before. It's unfortunate that it was underneath because you lose a bit of headroom, but it wasn't all underneath. Like it was reduced the depth of the truss, carrying a few other electrical trays and things. And just a little thing here, this box cord, the outer plate sticks up above and below it, and that was to form the rail for the maintenance travelers, so we didn't have to have a separate rail. Everything to save weight, much as we could. And using tubular construction, which we did some fatigue research in Germany to make sure that would work and all sorts of interesting things. So that's the idea. And the about the point we were just about to go for tender, they decided they wanted to widen the sidewalks. And there wasn't time to get it into a wind tunnel. So our parent company, COE, have a program. They're not the only ones that have it, but they do have a good program for simulating the wind flow in the wind tunnel. Discrete vortex method, they call it. And that you're seeing the result of that on the bottom. Later on, we were able to get into the wind tunnel. Was it you did that, Guy? Yeah. That was in Denmark. Yeah. So we did get into the wind tunnel after they'd done the calculations. It's so much easier to do the calculations when you already know the result. And the agreement was, on the whole, pretty good. I digress. So here we are. These are the troughs that are upside down. They're going to be part of the deck. This may be a little hard to see, but that's a trough upside down being welded to a deck plate with two weld heads. It's actually going away from us. And you're seeing the actual weld is here. And then this is what they call submerged arc. And this is basically a vacuum cleaner that picks up all the loose flux here, which is a powder. The fabricating is actually very difficult. Here again, we've got a section, the test section. This is the deck plate, still upside down, and there's the trough. This is an ultrasonic detector that the guy that used it made it himself, and it really worked well. This is the critical weld. You want to make this as full a weld as you can. Otherwise, you get fatigue problems because there's a crack in there. As the traffic runs over, the deck will flex. You'll get cracks. You'll get problems. And you can see here that that really wasn't good enough. We were aiming for preferably 90% penetration. 90% penetration means 10% not welded. And when you consider it's only an 8-millimeter plate, this is less than, we're tolerating less than a millimeter or about a millimeter unwelded. It's very difficult to get that done. And the fabricators, which was Canron in Vancouver, did a brilliant job of getting it right. This was one of the ones that wasn't quite right, but part of the process. So now we have a bunch of troughs welded to the deck plate, still upside down. Those are the transverse beams. Also, oh, actually, they're the right way up, as it happens. But they've got these cutouts to take the troughs. Now those plates, transverse beams, have been turned upside down to fit over the troughs. And that big strong beam on top is to push it all down to make sure it fits tightly. The deck panels themselves here are not connected. So they haven't been welded together. There's a panel here, panel over here, panel out here. So they're not actually welded together at this point. But the transverse beam is all one piece. You see it better from this side, perhaps. So this is going to be a splice. This is going to be cut through. But at the time it was built, this was all one piece. That weld wasn't made, and the deck weld wasn't made. But it all fitted. And then, because you can't turn the whole thing over, it's just too big, they cut through the floor beams. It was really very clever and turned them up. So there's one that has been cut free. That's a middle one, somewhere in the middle of the roadway. And that's ready to go. So that gets turned the right way up. There's the bottom cord. You can see that ledge I was talking about on the right-hand side that the traveler wheels will run along. That's a sidewalk panel, or part of a sidewalk panel, upside down here, just about to be turned the right way up. There's a stiffening truss, also upside down. And now everything's being turned the right way up, and the bits are assembled into larger panels. The deck plates are now welded together, which is what you're seeing here. And you can see the effect of the trough welds here. It does affect the steel. It was welded from the other side, upside down, but you can see them. Then it was mandatory that each section of bridge had to be matched to the previous one so to make sure we had exactly the right geometry. And the holes were then reamed and marked so that there were certain holes that absolutely had to line up in the field, and then the rest would fit, we hoped. Then inside a temporary tent, we did the first bit of the paving. This is another problem. Won't go into it, but you do need paving on the bridge. And we elected to do what we call pre-paving, which was this epoxy slurry with chips sprayed into it, cast into it, and then rolled. And then when that was cured, it was very tough, and the traffic could run on that for up to a year before putting the final paving on. Paving of orthotropic decks is very difficult. There have been a very large number of failures. So there's the panel ready to go, painted, and the gray paint is where there's going to be a splice plate. There it is, arriving at the dock near the bridge, the temporary bulkhead, ready to go, as you can see. This is the first weekend. Certain pieces you couldn't do at night, so we had to close it for one or two weekends. This was the first weekend. The first piece that you take out, which is that one, is by far the most difficult. And the reason it's, let me go back, the reason it's the most difficult is you have to pull it out of the cable bent and then lower it, but you can't pull it out because of the rest of the bridges there. Once you've made one gap, you can give yourself a bit of leeway. And the thing on top here is the what they call the jacking traveler, which is what lifted the piece up and down. Okay, so once you've got it on the jack, this is perhaps a little further down, then they cut through the bridge on both sides. Very spectacular it was while they were using their oxygen lances. And here's the first piece coming down, which you see quite clearly. And this is later on. This is a more typical piece. In the foreground, there's an old piece going down. Behind us, the work front has got as far as here. And this chappie that's standing on it, his role is just to make sure that nothing snags as it goes down. As soon as it's clear, he comes up on a ladder and gets off the piece that's being lowered. Meanwhile, he's on some kind of a safety line. I can't see, but he was. You can see some interesting things behind. These devices are the gap between the old hangers, which stopped at the top, the old truss top cord, and the new truss is much lower. So there's a gap in between. And in those, put these adjustment devices, because as we're doing this, you have to really tweak it up and down to make sure you get A, the right geometry, and B, the right stresses. Otherwise, you can overload this as you're going. It's actually quite fancy. This is another weekend one. We were able to get a daytime shot, and you can see this just walking from the left to the right at the main tower. There's a piece just going up off the barge. There it is, another view from the airplane. This is a piece coming up, and the old is on the left, the new is on the right. Now the piece is up and connected to the new is connected to the previous new and to the old with a temporary holding, and it's just about ready for to be open for traffic. In the last hour or so, they had to do up approximately 700 bolts, which if you think about it, is an awful lot of bolts when you think how long it takes to put one in and tighten it up and torque it and measure it and check it and move on to the next one. And meanwhile, further back down the bridge, the welding of the deck plate, you couldn't do that the same night. There just wasn't time. So you bring a piece up, you bolt it to the previous new piece, but you can't weld the deck. So that has to happen later. So this was happening further back down the line. And there we are in the daytime. It's interesting that there's a bit of a downward cusp at the junction. That's really because, A, we've got a hinge joint here, and B, because you've got this heavy weight of the temporary equipment. But it was a bit alarming for some. I was asked to go and talk to the bus drivers' union about whether or not it was safe. I hope I was credible. So there we go. The new piece, being lighter than the old at the time we lifted it up, had to have ballast. Why was it lighter? It was lighter because it hadn't had the final paving on yet, which was, as we've agreed, was a significant amount of weight. So we had to put blocks on to act as counterweight, otherwise it would get a bit out of balance. And this is the very last piece going in, which was put in a bit differently. And that also was a weekend piece because it was so difficult. Then once it's all in and the weather's nice, looks like it was around July 21st of 2002, then we pave it. And that's with another epoxy paving, a very specialized epoxy, mixture of epoxy and asphalt. And you add another 37 millimeters, sounds very precise, but that's an inch and a half. and eventually it's all done. So there we go. That's all part of the paving. The trucks have to drive off on these boards because their wheels get covered in the epoxy bond coat. There we go, getting it all rolled and everything. And at the same time, we increased the ship protection and the earthquake resistance too, for that matter. That's as the, this is the earthquake bit, yeah. That's the pedestal as it was. And then up top left here, we put a whole cage of rebar. That was just a mass concrete, which isn't good for earthquakes, as Dr. Humar will probably tell you. And so we encased it all in steel, and then had to put more facing, stone facing, around the outside. That came from India, I think. So that's the way it was before we started. And that's the way it was after we finished. You see an improvement in the view of the mountains because there are no clouds. The orange thing is the vertical hangars have been changed to the gray color they should be. But it's a whole lot better. You're much more safe, and it works very well. Interestingly, that's taken during construction of the bridge. But of the original bridge, that's all that remains. So the rest has been redone. But nobody notices, and this great icon of Vancouver is apparently untouched. So while we're bragging about it, this is the once it was finished. And to summarize what we learned on it, first of all, we really, I think, almost invented the current science of long-span bridge loading. There had been work done earlier, but I think it was done a lot better here. With that, once you've worked out the load, you've also got to work out what's a suitable safety factor. And so we worked on that. We developed this survey and analyze method. We learned about the long-term cable stretch that everybody said doesn't happen. We learned about the radiant cooling and the variability of the bridge temperature. We learned about the dynamic modeling, that the way we calculated in the computer didn't give us the same result as actually happened on site. At least, not for the amplitudes we were measuring. We learned something about the structural damping that we were able to measure. One of the interesting things was setting criteria for the aerodynamic stability. After Tacoma Narrows blew down, all bridges were made as aerodynamically stable as possible. And one of the questions we asked was, so how good is good enough? Does it have to be perfect? I mean, how good does it have to be? And it was something actually that Bob and I had worked on some years before, trying to establish what are the rules of the game. When you got to a certain critical velocity, when is it good enough? So that was kind of fun. We learned a lot about the effects of turbulence, as I mentioned. And I think it was Peter Irwin developed credible buffeting theory. It had been done before by Alan Davenport, so it was a refinement. And there were a number of firsts, which was, as you can see that, that's, as I say, has been done now on a number of other bridges. And then the pinning and rotation of the footings I don't think had been done before. There was easily the first large model tested in turbulent flow. There have been even bigger ones since then, but that was a big jump up by a factor of 4 or 5 in terms of size. And the first full replacement of the suspended structure at night only, and that we're planning to do on the MacDonald Bridge in Halifax I think we're going out to tender at the end of this year. So it'll be similar, but different, which is very interesting. It's actually more difficult than this one, so it's a good job we did this one first. And that's the story of the Lionsgate Bridge. And that's almost, but not quite, the end of my talk, because these things were all in the past, so I thought I'd try and bring you up to date with what we're currently doing. And for that, I need 2 volunteers. May I have 2 volunteers? How about, you're a good volunteer. I need one more. Okay. You have to hold that end of the chain. And you have to hold this end of the chain. Yeah. And what we're going to do is we're going to hold it up so that this pink tag is in line with this pink tag. So you've got to come this way. You've got to hold it at the end, not anywhere else. Okay, so you've got to reach up so that you've got some reasonable, not too tight, but you've got to come this way a bit. So can everybody, is that matching from the back? Okay, maybe we let it down a wee bit. Can you let it just come slack? Just let it come towards me a bit. Yeah, that's it. Now, do you want to hold that one there? Right. So now that's the middle of the bridge, that marker. Now, the unusual thing about suspension bridges is most bridges, when you put a vertical load on them, they deflect vertically, but they don't deflect in other directions, sideways or longitudinally. But my keys here represent a large amount of traffic loading. And if I put the traffic, shall we say, here, that you guys don't move or you'll screw this up. There we go. What happens? It moves to the left. All right, and if they'd been more slack, it would have moved more to the left. So now, if this half of the bridge is loaded with traffic, and this half of the bridge is not loaded with traffic, then the thing's going to move this way. And the roadway, which is attached to the cables, is going to move with it. The problem is, the code says you should put the traffic in the most in the worst place, the most severe place, which would be to load exactly this half and exactly not that half. But does that really happen? Does the traffic actually ever get to be all on one bridge at its maximum intensity, which is what the code tells you should use, and not at all on that side? So thank you very much, pylons. That's been really good. So what we're trying to find out now is what does happen. The reason being that, what did I do with my clicker? There we are. This is for one of the two bridges in Halifax. We're doing both of them, actually, but this is the McKay Bridge, not the MacDonald one. But at each tower, there's an expansion joint to allow for heat, temperature effects, longer and shorter. But you've also got this effect now of swaying longitudinally because of vertical traffic. That's nothing to do with horizontal forces like braking forces or acceleration, and nothing to do with wind. So you've got the temperature effect, you've got the wind effect, you've got the braking effect, but you've also got this vertical effect of traffic, which is actually quite severe if you work it out in terms of the motion needed at the expansion joint. Expansion joints are very expensive. They run into the millions. So if you could find a way of cutting that down, that would be perhaps, if you could cut it down, yes, you'd save a lot of money. So we're in the middle of a research program now on this and its sister bridge, the MacDonald, to see what actually happens as opposed to what the code tells you should happen. It seems to be fraught with difficulty. We're having continual power outages and other frustrating things happening. But so that's brought you up to date. So if somebody looked a bit old, I can assure you there's still very interesting things going on right now. And that's up to date. See what happens in the future. But I think if I've not contributed anything else, I hope I've shown that I've had the luck to have a wonderful career. And this was only really two, maybe three projects out of many. So thank you all very much for listening.
Thank you, Peter. We have about 10 minutes for questions that you may want to address to the speaker. And hope, Peter, you would be willing to answer some of them. If you do want to ask a question, please raise your hand, and a volunteer will take the microphone to you. That way you can identify yourself and ask your question. Okay, questions? Yes, here. Please take the microphone there. Okay, yeah.
I work on ships, and if you have to do a deck loading for a ship and you know that you're going to be carrying trucks and cars, you actually do take the worst case scenario and say, what happens if it's full of trucks? So I'm surprised that they wouldn't do the same for the bridge. Are you getting into some kind of probabilistic? What are the chances of it all being trucks? Or is that, how are you approaching that?
Yes, that's exactly right. I mean, if you're loading things onto a ship, I presume you can measure them as you put them on. You can weigh them or know what the weights are. We have traffic using the bridge every day, and we haven't any idea what it is, including overloads that shouldn't be there. So we're measuring traffic in various ways and then trying to say...
So what's the extreme thing that you could get with a maximum return period of, say, 5 years or 500 or whatever you want to do? The sort of sequel, which is what we were talking about this last minute, is not only what is the loading, but where is it? Is it really all in the worst place? I doubt it. But without doing some measurements, you can't be sure of that. There's bound to be some vehicles on the other side, which make a big difference, actually, because they pull that orange tag back. So you don't need such a big expansion joint. So it is a probabilistic basis, though. You're right. And we've measured some other things, too, on these bridges on the same basis. You're looking for something for what will happen with a sufficiently low probability. The analogy that I use often, actually, but I gave a talk on this, something like this anyway, in Toronto one time. And I flew in, checked in at the hotel, sat down on the corner of the bed, and the leg broke off. And so when I gave my talk, I pointed out that I really don't want the leg on my bed to fail when I sit down. But even more, I don't want the wing to fall off my airplane when I'm flying home. So since I know that planes do crash and the probability of occurrence is not therefore zero, we've got to set some kind of acceptable probability for both. And if the bed leg broke only, say, once a year, that'd probably be all right. But I would hope that my airplane would be sort of one in 10,000 or a million or something per year probability. So they're neither of them zero, but we're trying to set what seems like a reasonable safety. And I don't know if that's answered the question.
Yes, and the other second part is this business of the chain.
Yeah.
The whole bridge shifts laterally from end to end a little bit. I can envisage that the worst case scenario is the bridge is closed one day, and then somebody opens the barrier and everybody charges across together en masse. You don't want that situation, so there has to be some control on how you let the traffic flow onto the bridge. Otherwise, you would have that worst case scenario.
Well, yes, there's two things there. It gets interesting. You're absolutely right. And first of all, there's two-way traffic. So traffic would be coming from both ends. But the code says we have to design our bridges in case they ever become one-way, like you might build another bridge alongside, and they're both one-way, so you've got to treat it as if it were one-way. Second thing is, we know that when traffic is moving, it spaces out quite a lot, and the maximum intensity of loading is always with the traffic virtually stationary, or at best, a crawl. So you've got to have some sort of a blockage at this critical point where the traffic all backs up behind it. So you've got a number of things that have to happen. They've got to be this exactly the worst point. The traffic's got to back up behind there and then stop with no traffic behind that to get the worst case for example, the expansion joint movement, just half a span loaded, the other half span not at all loaded. And is that could happen, but is it also going to coincide with the worst loading seen in 100 years? It doesn't seem very likely.
Yeah.
It's just that we don't know until we measure something. So that's what we're trying to do.
Ada, you have a question? Yeah.
Question about climate change induced design factor changes. Knowing that the bridges have life of 100 years, 70 years, in coastal areas there are going to be major effects, extreme episodes of wind, wave, water level changes, and so on. Is there anything in the design codes or in your experience where such a thing can be handled? And in particular, what does it do to the cost, given that there are a lot of uncertainties here?
Well, that's a fair question. It involves either peering into a glass ball to pretend we know what might happen, or just being a bit conservative, just in case. And I'd have to say, most of the projects that I've worked on probably didn't consider that very much. The change is mostly being fairly slow. One of the interesting things of global warming, I'm told, and there are people here who are expert who will know better than I, but I'm told that the waters off, for example, Prince Edward Island, where I was working on Confederation Bridge, the water, because of global warming, the water is actually getting colder. And that's because the Arctic ice mass is melting and the icebergs and things are drifting down south and actually cooling the water. So one of the big questions on Confederation Bridge, which is largely governed by ice, is what's going to happen? I think the problem there was so much uncertainty that it was kind of swamped by any change there might be in climate. So to tell you the truth, I don't think it's well thought through. No. And I can't claim that I've thought through a lot. We do sort of keep it in mind. If in doubt, well, we might as well put a bit more on. There's another big thing, though. It just so happens, by coincidence, that all the three bridges I've talked about have been suspension bridges. I didn't set out to do that. I had some other really interesting ones. The other thing is they're all renovations. And when you're building a new bridge, you can say, well, you know, water levels might go up, so I can design this for some higher water level or some bigger traffic load or some bigger wind load or something like that, and you'd be okay. If you've got an existing bridge, you typically can't do that. It's struggling to carry what you're trying to carry now, let alone some unknown extra load in the future. So if you can make a bit of extra capacity, that's fine. But typically, you're right on the edge. That's why we did all the research on Lions Gate, because by the conventional wisdom of the time, it didn't work, period. Neither for wind, nor for traffic loading, nor for a bunch of other things. So the only way we could make it work was to see, well, are we really accurate? Is the code accurate, or is the code conservative? The code should be conservative, because it's got to cover so many different situations. So I'm okay with that. But in any case, it might not be.
I'll try to speak very loud.
You've got a mic coming.
I was interested in your efforts to try to determine what the natural frequency of the structure was and the damping. I was fortunate enough a few years ago to be able to witness some testing of concrete structures in Utah which were slated for destruction or demolition, and they were pushing them and pulling on them until they cracked them, and they were measuring, they were exciting the structures before and after they did this, and I think the idea was that they would use this potentially as a tool to determine if there'd been any change in the structure as a result of an earthquake.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, these were concrete structures, and they would crack, and the dynamic properties would change significantly when they did crack. But I'm wondering, what it did point out is that this is just not a fixed number for all time for a structure. And there is a possibility that this is a property that will change, you know, as the structure experiences changes. So I'm just wondering if you have any comments on that topic with respect to this type of bridge, or if that could happen in a steel bridge.
Yeah, well, I do have a comment. I think you've got a very good point there, because we need to know why is it the way it is, not what's going on, but why. So for example, the example we had with Lions Gate, the measured frequency was quite a bit more than the calculated frequency, because these many things weren't happening. These breather joints particularly were not moving. They were kind of rigid because the friction was too great. If we only measured them, we'd say, aha, that's the natural frequency. When we calculate it, we get a different number, which may be more like it will be if you increase the amplitude, because as the amplitude increases, maybe they will begin to slide, and that will drop the frequency, and that might be very serious. You get a big wind that does get, you know, buffets the bridge to the point where they're coming free, the natural frequency drops, and that's exactly what you don't want in a big wind. So I think the learning is to really understand it and know not just what you've got, but why you've got what you've got. So I agree with you. What you were talking about sounds very interesting.
I think we have to close the questions at this time. You'll have opportunity to speak to Peter later on at the reception. Thank you once again for your very exciting topic and talk. And at this time, I'd like to invite our chair, Paul Van Giel, to give a token of our appreciation, a small presentation to our speaker.
All right, thanks, Jack. Before I jump to thanking our speaker, after every lecture, there's always a takeaway or a couple takeaways. And I've got three takeaways. One is that Peter has led a very impressive career, as evidenced by an excellent introduction from Siva, and the examples that he showed today. Secondly, there's a lot of innovation to come up with an idea of replacing a bridge deck while the bridge has to maintain operating conditions during the day, or correcting the support of the base to make it a pivot versus a fixed thing. And the third will always spark some discussion in my department, and that is if you're a structural engineer and you have the chance to blame it on the geotechnical engineer, you take that chance. But with that, I would like to thank Peter very much on behalf of the department for an excellent presentation. We have three small tokens of appreciation. The first is a plaque, and a similar plaque exists in the department that your name will be added to. And it is a picture of the National Arts Center, which is one of John's favorite buildings. Secondly, there is a print here so that you can remember your trip to Ottawa. And actually, this funny thing called the canal goes right by the NAC.
Oh, that's fantastic. Yes. So
thank you. And finally,
I'm going to need to build some more walls. I see you're testing some downstairs, so that's good.
Finally, here's a small photo of a very good-looking guy that we took earlier today, giving today's address of the John Ajalian Lecture. Oh. So with that, I'd like to extend a warm thank you to Peter for an excellent talk and for coming up.
Well, thank you very much indeed. Thank you all. That's very quick service, isn't it?
It's our practice at this time in this lecture every year to recognize the good work done by our students. And we want to give awards to those who have won some recognition. I'd like to call upon Professor Hassan to conduct this award ceremony.
Elizabeth, would you like to join me, please, given the awards? As Jacques mentioned, every year we'd like to recognize some of our graduate students. And this year we have a good number to recognize. And without really any specific order, except for the first one, because the first one is the winners of the John Ajalian Graduate Scholarship. We have three winners this year from architecture. No order really specific here. Bassam Dawood. Xiaoning Zhang. I think he is not coming. Vince Fogg. The graduate scholarship in civil engineering was given this year to a number of students, Joshua Woods. Dina Migala. Dina also won the Queen Elizabeth II Graduate Scholarship in Science and Technology. Another winner of the Queen Elizabeth II Graduate Scholarship in Science and Technology is Jonathan Grimes. the third winner of Queen Elizabeth's second graduate scholarship in science and technology is Sayed Murtaza Misbah. We have an award, Jack Mohan Humar Graduate Student Fellowship for Civil and Environmental Engineering, and it was won by Human Turabi. Professor Atta Khan's Sustainable Transportation Graduate Scholarship was won by Mustafa Al-Dulaimi. I think Mustafa is not here. SFP National Capital Region Chapter Scholarship for Fire Safety Engineering was won by Xiao Li. George? The Indira Gandhi Memorial Fellowship was won by Sinuthan Navaratnavel. Sorry. QSA scholarship was won by Hussein Burak Gunay. Just stay here. Hussein also won the John Lindhurst Kingston Memorial Scholarship. The Konungstein Scholarship for Excellence in Science and Engineering, Amanda Pappen. Stick around for your second. Another award that was won by Amanda is the Hamlin Graduate Fellowship. The Hamlin Graduate Bursary was won by Nada Al-Ani. She's not here. International Bridge Builder Scholarship, Thayaparan Thina Dayaral. The Bill Hirsch Memorial Graduate Scholarship, last but not least, was won by Tatiana Kolochkina, but I think she is not here today. Okay, congratulations. Then.
If you just hold on for a minute while we take some pictures. I think the architectural students, would you please come back here for a picture? Now, each year, the number of students winning the awards goes up, and it's really a success story for the department. I'd like to take this time to thank, first of all, our profound thanks to the speaker, Peter Buckland, for taking the time to come over here. We are really honored by his presence and his sharing the knowledge that he acquired, the experience that he has acquired with all of us. I'd also like to thank all my committee members who worked with me tirelessly on organizing this lecture event today, at Professor Haleem, Professor Sivathalan, Professor Bramya, and Professor Santana. And last but not the least, I think our profound thanks to Kay Castleman, our departmental secretary, without whose effort this would not have been possible. Thank you, Kay.